Right, good afternoon, everybody. So we welcome you to this Bachelor of Software Engineering Honours degree. And you have passed the selection test. You have submitted your application. You have passed your selection test. Now the next stage in your following this program is the registration. We want to give you some information about how to register and a few other details. Now, we have conducted several pre-orientation sessions. I would like to emphasize this program was going on from 2009. This is the first Bachelor of Software Engineering degree offered by state sector university in Sri Lanka. We launched in 2009. We have had many bachelors now, and most of our people are employed by the industry and recognized by the industry. This is the only degree that is delivered in open and distance learning mode, which is the hallmark of the Open University. We conduct our courses in open and distance learning mode, which is very flexible. Our model is very flexible. We allow the learners to learn at your own pace. If you don't know, the Open University was set up basically to cater for people who could not go to a state sector university or on full-time basis for many reasons. Some want to start working, some because of conditions they can't enter the university. So all these people, you can start this program even when you are working. You can learn at your own pace. That is one of the key characteristic of the ODL mode. And then you can study on your own time. We do not put any restrictions on the time. You study in the morning, you study in the night, you study wherever you want. And the location is also very flexible. You can study from wherever you are, so your life does not get affected. We have 28 centers all around the country. All our academic activities are conducted. Whenever there's a face-to-face activity, it's conducted in all these centers. So you don't have to travel to Colombo or any other place. You can follow the program in the place closest to you, except a very few cases you may have to come to Colombo, but that is very, very small amount of activities. Because of this pandemic, this program also got affected because there are many lockdowns, all these problems. But this time we are going to conduct it mainly online. But when the situation improves, we might conduct some face-to-face sessions so you can meet your tutors, you can meet your colleagues, your peers, when the situation improves. And we have also have the Open University has a strong, very strong learner support system. That is because we understand that you are learning on your own in the distance mode. So we have a very strong learner support system. We have, for example, for each subject, we are grouping you into a student 50 groups of 50, and there are one online tutor for each subject for each group. So you have a very close interaction with the tutors. They will be monitoring your progress. They will be supporting you. Whatever the problems is there, we will be helping you. And as many of you may know already, we are conducting this with very close interaction with SASCOM. SASCOM stands for Sri Lanka Association for Software and Services Companies, which is the largest umbrella organization, the chamber for IT companies. It is mainly consisting of all the large companies that are developing software for import. Right now, they are recruiting about 120,000 people. And one of the reasons that we decided that we are going to take a large number of students this year, usually we take between 150 to 200 students only for our Bachelor of Software Engineering degree. From many applications that we get, we do a selection test like the one you did, and we select about 150 to 200 students. But this time, we decided to open it to a much larger number. The reason being, the software industry is currently undergoing a major problem of not being able to find suitable people to sustain their growth and also going into new ventures. It is not an exact figure, but the estimate is that currently there are about 25,000 to 40,000 vacancies in the IT industry that they can't find people to fill it. And if you take the annual figures, annually, software industry requires about 22,000 new recruits. 22,000. The IT industry requires 22,000 people, but the entire university system, public and private, both together produce around 9 to 10,000 students. So already there's a gap of about 12,000 software engineers and other, those who are working in the IT field, software engineers, quality assurance engineers, etc. About 12,000 gap is there between what the universities are supplying and what the industry is needing. So what the industry did was they made a representation to the government, said, look, we want to become the largest income earner for the country by 2025. Our target is $5 billion, but we do have a problem because we can't find enough people. So the government looked around and they talked to the state sector universities, other state sector universities to increase their numbers, but they have limitations in increasing the number. They approached us and said, "Can you are the only university that can accommodate this number of people. Can you take up this challenge?" And we said, yes, you have the facility, we will do it. So government gave us the some funding to improve our infrastructure facilities, etc. And said, okay, take a large number. So we are willing to take up to, even up to 10,000 students for this program. And one more thing that we did, a very creative thing is that there is an organization called Coursera, which is an online course delivery system platform. And they have over 4,300 courses that are offered by the leading universities in the world, including the Imperial University of London, Duke University, and many other world universities are offering their courses through this Coursera platform. So we had a discussion with them, we talked to them, and we said, okay, we want to use your courses in our program. Now we have signed an agreement, and you will be able to follow all these 4,300 courses after you register. And they vary from technology, it may be business, accounting. There are all sort of courses, even, you know, fun courses, and also, you know, personal development courses like language, presentation skills, etc. So, psychology, many, many different courses. So you will be able to access these courses. And out of these, we have identified some courses that are very similar to the courses that we are offering. So you will be following some of our curriculum through Coursera courses. You will do that, and then we will give you exemption for our courses once you get the certification. And these certifications are internationally valid, and some of these certificates actually give transferable credits worldwide that you can use if you want to go somewhere else. And they are worldwide recognized. So that is another salient feature of our software engineering degree program. So now going to the registration. Now what you have to do is, now you have got your login details for the ums.omic.org site. That is the site where we where you applied for this program, and where you made the application payment and booked a selection test slot. All that you need through this site. So you use the same credentials and you log into the system. When you log into the system, it will tell you, okay, now you have passed the selection test. You can move to registration, right? When you log in, it will tell you, you can move to the registration, and it will show you the courses that you have applied for. Now, in this case, this sample, that person has applied for two programs. You say, okay, I'm going to, in your case, most of you, it will be only a Bachelor of Software Engineering. So you say course registration. When you press course registration, it will take you to this next screen here. Next screen here, which lists the subjects that you have to select for the BSc program. Now here we are listing only the semester one subject. There are two semesters. We have a semester system. Each semester is 15 weeks. Then we will have a break and then we start the second semester. The subjects listed here are the subjects of the first semester. Now, as you can see, there are six subjects in the first semester. You can see one, two, three, four, five, six. Now, all these out of these, all these subjects are the top five are compulsory. Other one is optional subject that you can take. But these are the subjects that we offer in the first semester. And they have what we call a credit rating. Now, what is a credit rating? That is one of the questions that many people ask. A credit rating is a measurement of the breadth and depth of the content. For example, the first subject says it's a three-credit course. That means it has content where you will have to spend about 150 hours of learning activities. That includes all our day schools where you have sessions with our tutors, your lab classes, your assignments, all the other activities. All together, you will have to spend about 50 hours for each credit. So when it's a three-credit course, that means you have to spend about 150 hours. If it's a two-credit course, during that semester, you have to spend about 100 hours. But that is a guide. I mean, it doesn't mean that we will be measuring you whether you did exactly 100 hours or not. But roughly, that is the amount of work that you have to put into follow that course, depending on the credit rating. Now, you can see there's one subject that is 4 credits. That means it has worked for about 200 hours of work. So that is the credit rating. So these are the subjects that you will follow in the first semester. And at the bottom, you can see there are two compulsory subjects. One is English for General Academic Purposes, which we call EGAP, which is an English course because this entire program will be conducted in English. So we have a course where it's more than pure English. It's about, you know, how to do academic writing, how to write a report, how to present an assignment, how to make a presentation. All that will be covered in this EGAP course. Then we also have another course you can see, Empowering for Independent Learning, which is because we understand most of you have done your O-levels, your A-levels. And all these courses, we have this teacher-based teaching model. That is that the teacher will come in front of the class, teach, you take notes, you go home and study. But here in the ODL mode, it is totally different because you as the learner has the total control over how you are going to study. But we understand that you need some support to move away from the traditional model of, you know, teacher-based teaching. So this Empowering for Independent Learning is the module that will give you all the necessary tools, practices, and methodologies for learning on your own. How to get support from others, how to contact, how to read, how to do assignments, or all that, how to manage your time, how to prepare a mind map to summarize your course, all that will be covered in this course called the Empowering for Independent Learning. And we consider these two courses very, very important for your academic career. But one thing that you have to understand is, even though I said that there are a large number of vacancies plus the industry need, just because you get a degree does not mean that industry will recruit you. You will need other skills. You will need teamwork skills. If you are not a team worker, you know, very unlikely that you will get into the industry because it's a team-based industry. Like presentation skills, communication skills, all these are required. So that is why we have made these two courses compulsory. When you follow these courses, you will get those skills that the industry is looking for. Like I said, we are working very closely with SASCOM as an organization. And they are telling us, okay, look, guys, your academic content, we don't have a problem. You are doing well. But we also need from these graduates these other skills. So we have incorporated them into our curriculum, we are constantly talking with them and arranging so that when you graduate from this, actually from the day one, that you are acquiring these skills that the industry is looking for, right? Okay. Then, once you have selected those subjects, it will take you to this screen like this, which tells you how much you have to pay. As you know, the Open University is partially funded by the government, it's subsidized by the government, but part of the cost the Open University has to bear. So that cost we recover from student fees, and it is very subsidized. The total degree for a software engineering degree will be less than 450,000 rupees. If you go to a private sector organization, it will be close to 2 million or even higher than 2 million. So it is subsidized by the government, highly subsidized. So it will tell you how much you have to pay. And after considering a student request, we also decided, okay, we will give you a installment scheme, because some students have said, okay, we can't pay that much money in one go. Now, for the first semester, if you look at this, it shows it is total fee is 51,000 rupees somewhere. Total. But out of that, you only have to pay the for the September, third installment, fourth installment. And these are the other fees that you have to pay compulsorily. That is a library fee, the faculty's facilities fee, the program registration fee. Then the start at OUSL, the program that I talked, EPIL and EGAP, all together we call it start at OUSL, how to start learning on your own. And the library deposit altogether, it comes to about 51,000, out of which you pay only the first installment if you want to follow. And also I want to tell you that though we are offering six subjects, many people ask this question also, I am working, I might not be able to take altogether it counts to 17 credits. So 17 credits is about 850 hours during the semester of 15 weeks. Some people say, okay, we can't do that much work because I'm working. Then in which case you have to select a few subjects, and your fee will be vary depending on the number of subjects that you select. So once you come to this screen, you can download a voucher, and then it will ask you, okay, are you sure that you have selected the subject that you want? Now, at this point, you can also go back and see, okay, I want to take some more courses. So, okay, I selected everything, but I think I can't do two courses. So you can change that. But once you come to this point and say yes, that means, okay, you have decided, okay, these are the courses that I'm going to do, and I'm willing to follow these courses. Once you say yes, it will take you to this screen saying, okay, these are the payments that you have to make. And it will also show you payments that you have already made if in the second semester and all that. Then when you press make payment, it will take you to the payment portal. Now here you can pay in different ways. You can pay using your debit credit card or the debit card. Now, one thing that I to warn you is, if you are using your debit card, some of you who tried to pay using debit card ran into problems. The system rejected your payment. It has nothing to do with us. It's with the bank. If you are going to pay through the debit card, make sure you call the bank and tell them, okay, authorize my card to make online payments. Right? That is between you and the bank, but you have to do that. If you don't do that, the bank will reject your payment and you will see, okay, I can't pay using my debit card. Your system is wrong. It is nothing to do with us. It is with the bank and you. When the bank gave the debit card, it says, okay, you can make payments online, but you have to call them and you get approval to make online payments from that bank debit card. So then you can pay that. Another way that you can pay is if you go to a bank branch, and that is a People's Bank branch, any People's Bank branch, you go with your voucher and you fill a deposit slip, and pay at the bank. Make sure when you are paying at the bank, you enter the correct voucher number. People have entered many different types of numbers, all sort of numbers. You have to remember that the way that we can know that it is you who made the payment is through this reference number, which is the voucher number. So you have to enter that voucher number into the system. When you enter the voucher number, it will automatically get updated in our system. Once you make the payment, bank will tell us, okay, this person with this voucher number made this payment, and it goes into our system and the system gets updated. This student paid this fee. The same happens with the credit card and the bank card. And also, when the situation improves, you might even be able to visit one of our centers, regional centers, and make payment in cash at the shop counter. That is also possible for you to do. Visit our centers, but right now we don't know when the country will be open for traveling. But when it happens, you can go to the center, take cash, and pay at the shop counter. Remember to take your voucher that you downloaded when you are going for the payment at the OUSL center. Then there are other two methods that are not listed here. One is the cash deposit machines of the People's Bank. There are machines there where you can put cash and make a payment to an account. There is a guide in our help desk, which I will describe in later, which gives the account number and account number details. You can go to the cash deposit machine, put our account number, and make the payment in cash into the machine. And the machine will give a receipt to you. Now, another way that you can do is to make an online transfer. That is from a direct transfer from your account to the OUSL account. That is also possible if you have online banking facilities. The only issue is that how to tally those numbers with our system. Right now, the cash deposit machines and online transfers are not linked to our system. We are talking to the banks, but they haven't been very accommodative yet. But eventually it will happen. But right now, if you do that, pay through the cash deposit machine or online transfer, what you have to do is to mail us your voucher, scan the voucher or take a photograph of the voucher or whatever, and the receipt. If it's a cash deposit machine, the cash deposit machine issues a receipt saying this person on this day transferred this much of money to this account. It gives our account number and everything, that receipt. Or if you make an online payment, that notification that you get that the transfer was successful, either one of these two and the voucher, you mail it to us. Then what we do is, at this end, we will look at your records and do a update our system that this has paid. Then only you can continue your work. So remember, if you are using the cash deposit machine or online transfer, you have to send us the receipt and the voucher so we can update our system from the back end. Right. So yeah, once you have made the payment, you go into the detailed application, what we call the detailed application, where you collect all the details that we need for our records. We ask for your name, your title, your initials, your last name, and your date of birth, age, etc. All this information is collected, and make sure that you enter this information carefully, because that is what goes into our system. And it says in the system for the next 4 years of your life, and the certificates are issued on this, letters are issued on these details that you are submitting and verifying on these numbers. So for example, you can't put your nicknames, etc. into this system because we will have no way of verifying. So fill it very carefully. And we will also ask your contact number, because that is how we connect contact you when we need to send you a notice, and your email address as well. And we had about almost 15,000 close to 15,000 applicants altogether, and some people have not entered their email address correctly. Your own email address. Some letter was missing, or instead of .com, you put .com. Instead of Gmail, you put gmail. All sort of errors. What happens when you don't enter your data carefully is, when we communicate with you, when we send an email, usually there are 40, 50 emails that bounce back saying, okay, this email address is invalid. That is not our fault. It is your fault that you have not entered your data correctly. So make sure that you very carefully check the data you are entering, because these are the information that we are using to communicate with you. And during this process also, you will have to upload some documents. Like, for example, national identity card number. Here we are asking for you to upload your national ID number, a national ID card. So you have to take a photograph or scan your national ID card and upload it. So here it says choose a file. So when you choose a file, it will ask where the file is, and you can select the file and upload it. One thing that you have to be very careful is that each one of these, you will have to submit several documents, like your A-level certificate, your A-level certificate, or any other academic qualifications, and your work experience. All these documents you will have to upload in the subsequent screens. And there is a limit to the file size. But sometimes some of you have very high resolution phones. If when you take a photograph, that photograph will be 5-6 megabytes of. As a limit, it says 500 kilobytes. It has to be smaller than this, otherwise the system will reject it. So in this case, what can you do? There are online converters that you can go, or you can download some of them as well, and convert this file into a smaller size file. So you have to upload, for example, the national ID card. You have to upload it as a .png file. That is a graphic format. Convert it into a PNG file of a smaller size, less than 500 kilobyte, and upload it. Because we are telling you this because in some students who tried to upload, could not upload, and they call us, they send us email saying, your system doesn't work. It didn't allow me to upload my A-level certificate or my national ID card and whatnot. And when we looked at it, the problem was that those files are too big for the system to accept, so the system rejects them. This is only 500 kilobyte. Other documents, usually there's a limit of 1 megabyte. So when you convert it into a PDF, even if it's a large file, it becomes much smaller. So use the online converter and make sure that the file size matches with the conditions that are given there. Right. Then once you have done that, there will be several screens like this where they ask different information, like your A-level certificate, your O-level certificate, your other educational qualifications, your work experience. If you have documents, upload them so we can take a look at them. And because of this pandemic, we can't verify your documents right now. And we trust that on your honesty. So we will accept the documents that you have submitted, and on the basis of that, we will give you a provisional registration. When the situation improves, we will ask you, we will send you a notice to come to our centers with the original document and the photocopies, and show it to one of our staff members to see that these certificates are real certificates, that they are valid. We will verify them and file them. At that point only, your registration will be confirmed. Right now, you get a provisional certificate, and if we find, okay, somebody has lied and given false information, that registration will be cancelled at that point. And many people also asked, you know, we haven't got our A-level results yet. That's okay. You go to the National Exam Department site, enter your index number, then your results will be displayed. Download that result sheet and upload that as your A-level certificate. Later on, we will have time to get your original certificate and verify it. Right now, we are interested in knowing, okay, this guy has, or this girl has 3 passes to follow the program. So go to the website exam department website and download the result sheet and upload it. Right. Okay, so that is the basics of filling this application. And if you have any problems, you can always contact us. I will talk to you about the help desk that we have set up for you to submit your queries. You now register this. You will select subject, and then you will register, finalize the registration. After you finalize the registration, we will give you access to our learner management system, where all our material is there, where our classes are conducted, everything. We will give you access to that. We will give you a username and password. We will give you a Open University email address and a password as well. After you register, we will be using that Open University provided email address for our own, all our communication. After that, we will not use your private email address for our communication because it is in the system. Sometimes the system automatically generates notifications to you. Okay, a class is at that time. Lab class is at this time. It will automatically use your student ID number related email address for communication. But that happens only after you register. Registration is finalized only. You will get the Open University email address. You will also get a username and a password to access our learner management system. Right? Okay. Now, now you will fill this, and in early July, we will be starting your orientation program, which we call Start at OUSL. But we also have what is known as the ad-drop period. Now, what is this ad-drop period? Now, say you select all six academic subjects when you are registering. Okay, I want to do all six. So you go to the orientation program and you see that the workload is too much. And you realize that, okay, I can't do all six subjects because I'm working. I have a family to look after. I have children to look after. So I will not be able to dedicate that much time. Then we allow you to drop some subjects. Say you have selected all six subjects. Okay, I can only do four subjects. So at that point, we will allow you to remove two subjects from your list. Oh, now you select four subjects, and when you are going through the orientation program, you realize, oh no, I can do this. This is not that difficult as I thought. I want to add the other two subjects as well. That also you can do during this ad-drop period. The ad-drop period will happen in September. So you register now and make payments and follow the Start at OUSL program. And in September, you can decide which courses you want to drop or which courses you want to add. That is why we call it ad-drop period. And also, during this ad-drop period, you will also select the second semester subject. Right now, you will only select the first semester subject, which are all compulsory. And in the second semester subjects also, you will add and drop, or you will add during the ad-drop period. But to decide on the second semester subject during the Start at OUSL program, we will be very closely discussing with you, interacting with you to guide you which subjects you should select, what workload you can take. All that we will be discussing with you and helping you to make those decisions. So until September, you will go through the orientation program, and in September, you will decide what subject you are going to register in the second semester, as well as which subject you want to add or drop from the first semester. Before the semester starts, you can do that. Two subjects that you can't drop is the EGAP and the EPhil, because these are compulsory subjects. If you want to get a degree, you have to do these subjects, otherwise we will not allow you to continue. So you have to complete this English for general academic purposes for your own good, and empowering for independent learning. That is how you can learn on your own independently. These two subjects are compulsory, so you have to complete that. And another thing that happens during this orientation period is what we call future careers challenges. Now, future careers challenges is a series of challenges that SLASCOM member companies got together and has designed 29 challenges. that anybody can go and register and do. We will be having a session with SASCOM. SASCOM will come and explain to you what these challenges are and what they are significance to you for your career. But as a brief introduction, these challenges are go from a very simple one like creating an email account, creating a blog site, to developing complex software. What the SASCOM member companies will be doing is they will be looking at your progress in these challenges. So there are many people. Right now, they have thousands of people who have registered from all over the country. Not those who are doing our degree program, but from other people also, they go through the challenges. When the SASCOM companies look and see, oh, there is this bright guy who has done all these challenges well, they will interview them and they will be recruited as interns or associate software engineers, depending on the company. They will recruit you. So during this orientation period, from now until September, you will also do these challenges. And we will be also closely monitoring your progress on this. But these challenges have to be done by yourself. In the session with SASCOM, they will explain to you how to register and what you have to do for these challenges. But this is just a brief introduction. You can go to this futurecareersbridge.net and take a look at what is there. But one thing, be very careful, listen very carefully. We want you to put your OUSL registration number. After you register, you get a registration number. You have to register at the Future Careers Bridge site using your OUSL number, because that is the only way that we can find out of these thousands and thousands of students who are the students of OUSL who are following the program, so we can support you and monitor you. Right. So remember that. Wait till you get your registration number, student number, before you register for the Future Careers Bridge Note. If not, what will have to happen is that you will have to re-register once you get the number, because that is the only way that we have to we can know this is one of our students who is following this program. Right. Then a little bit about our terminology that we are using. Each one of our courses, we call every subject, we call it a course. Our courses have a code. The course consists of three letters and four digits. Now let me explain what this course code is, the code that we have designed. The first two numbers define which department offers this subject. Now, for example, if you see it's AG, that subject is offered by this agriculture and plantation engineering. Some of the, like communication skills, etc., offered by this department. The mathematics subjects are offered by the mathematics department. Computing subjects are offered by our electrical and computer engineering department. So the first two digits represent the department. Then the next, first two letters, the third letter represent the category of the course. Now, what do you mean by a category of course? We have different types of courses here. We have what we call engineering type of courses. We have project, engineering projects. We have mathematics related subjects. We have industry related subjects that are very close to industrial needs. Then we have some general subjects like communication skills are general subjects. We have computer literacy. We have English related subjects, management related subjects, and one subject that called training, which is a compulsory part of this program. So the third letter define what category of a course this is. Then there are four digits. Out of the first digit, the first digit tells you what level this subject is. So you will find that some subjects have number 3 here, some subjects will have number 4, 5, 6. That means that is the level. Now you are entering at level 3 in the SLQF framework, that is the national framework for quality assurance. Level 3 is the start of the degree. Level 1 and 2 are certificate and diploma levels. Level 3 is the first year of the degree. So level 3 subjects you will be following now. Then you will, next year when you go, it will be level 4 subjects, level 5 subjects, and level 6 subjects. So that is the level. Then the last two digits is just a sequence number that we are giving to courses, a series, serial number, which goes from 01 to 99. That's a serial number on this category. So that is the code that we use for our courses. Because these are things that you will need when you are looking, okay, what does this number mean, right? Okay, now these are the semester one courses that we have. Like I said, we are conducting the program or delivering the program over two semesters. Each semester is 15 weeks. And the first semester, all the subjects are compulsory. There are six subjects. And if you add the credit numbers, here there are four. Here credit, these are all level three. You can see all these are level three. Some are offered by the mathematics department. Some are offered, most of them are offered by the electrical and computer engineering department. Some subjects are engineering work subjects. Some subjects are industrial related subjects. So that is why it's I, this is X. Z is mathematics. This MH means mathematics department. Then all are level three subjects. Then this is the credit rating. 4, 8, 11, 13, 15, 17. So altogether there are six courses and 17 credits. So if you want to finish your degree program in exactly in 4 years, you will have to take around 33 to 35 credits every year, because altogether there are 130 credits for the degree program. You have to get 130 credits, satisfy 130 credits to get a degree. If you want to complete in full time, you will have to take all the subjects and 17 credits if you want to finish it in 4 years. But it's not compulsory to finish it in 4 years. You have up to 12 years to complete the degree, because we understand some people might not be able to do all the courses every year. 35 credits you might not be able to do. Some might be able to do 20 or 15, whatever. The minimum requirement for to register for a year is you take 8 credits. Minimum, you have to take 8 credits. And that is why we have listed down here EX3467, 3346, and 3266. These are three subjects that are here. 3266 is here, 3346 is here, and 3467 is here. We recommend that you take these three subjects. Why do we recommend this? Because when you are doing level four subjects, some of these subjects become prerequisites. That means to do those subjects, you must have completed these subjects. That is usual practice in the university. When you are going to higher levels, we expect you to have the lower level knowledge to follow that subject. So these three have become very important subjects, because these subjects will define whether you can do some courses in the second year. If you haven't done some of these courses, though some of the courses that are in the second semester, you might not be able to follow because you have not completed this, and that is a prerequisite for those subjects. So we recommend, if you are going to take less than a total number of credits, at least you have to select these subjects in the first semester. Right, so these are the semester one courses for the BSc degree program. We have these six subjects, and like I said, semester two subjects, you will decide in September, you will register for these courses in semester two. And one of the characteristics of this degree program is, although you are entering for the Bachelor of Software degree program, after the level one completes, that's level three completes, that is the first year completes, you have a choice. You can do BSc in computer science, or you can do BSc in IT. You can decide, okay, I want to do BSc in computer science, not the Bachelor of Software Engineering, or I want to do a BSc in IT, not Bachelor of Software Engineering. You will have that option when you complete the level three, that is the first year. Only condition is that these two paths, whether you are doing BSc or whether you are doing computer science or IT, there are subjects that you have to select. Because if you are doing a Bachelor of Software Engineering, we expect you to do these courses. These are the compulsory courses. These three are compulsory, which is 2, 4, 6, 13 credits are compulsory. Sorry, 12 courses credits are compulsory. Then out of these four courses, you have to select three courses. These are out of these three, four courses, you have to select three courses. If you are planning to do the Bachelor of Software Engineering degree, but that is in the second semester, right? So during the orientation period, you will make a decision, okay, I want to do the Bachelor of Software Engineering degree, then these are the subjects that you have to select. But during this period, if you think, okay, I want to do computer science or IT, then the subjects are these. These are compulsory. These subjects are compulsory. You have to do them. Then out of these two, you select one subject. Either you select programming in Python or you want to do introduction to business studies. Why is there an option? Some people already know Python, so you want to learn about the business skill. Some people already coming from commerce stream, you might have your business skill, so you decide, okay, I want to learn programming. But these subjects here are compulsory. You have to, you must do these things to get your degree. So these are the subjects for software engineering. These are the subjects for computer science and IT. So when you, if you decide that you want to do a computer science or IT, you should do these compulsory courses and select one of these subjects. If you are going to do software engineering, you do these three compulsory subjects and select three out of these four. Then another feature of the Open University system is that we can recognize some of the qualifications that you have got somewhere else. For example, we get people who have done British Computer Society certificate. If you have done some other course outside, we can recognize your learning that you have acquired through those courses. For example, if you have done British Computer Society certificate, we tell you, okay, you don't have to do this. You don't have to do this subject. We will exempt you from this. We will give you the credit for this subject. You don't have to do it. You will get off for free. And sometimes some people come, you know, they have done the NIBM diploma in computer system design, in which case we tell you, okay, you don't have to do this subject, 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 you don't have to do this subject. All these subjects will be, we will consider that as you have passed those subjects, we will give you credit for this subject, you don't have to repeat those subjects here. The only condition that we have is we can only recognize up to 50% of the credit through this recognition of prior learning or qualification that you have acquired elsewhere. Only 50%, even if you have done 100% of our course, still you will have to do 50% from our course for to get one of our degrees. Right. Now, one question that comes is, okay, how do I get exemption? Now, if you go to our guidebook on this side, you go to our website, ou.ac.lk/BSc Honours, you will find the guidebook. The guidebook lists all the exemptions that we have already recognized, like NIBM Diploma, the British Computer Society, the BIT, all the known qualifications that we have evaluated previously is listed there. So if you have one of those qualifications, you don't have to do anything. It will be automatically recognized and you will be given exemption. But sometimes students come with other qualifications that are not listed there. Equivalent qualification. You may have done a degree in some other university and in the first year you may have done a programming course. So you think, okay, this course is very similar to the courses at the Bachelor of Software Engineering degree program. Can I get an exemption for this course? Yes, you can apply. And if you go to Appendix 3 of this guidebook, it is very well laid out. There's an application form. And it also tells you which document you should submit to get exemption for other qualifications that are not listed there. So what you do is, fill that form, then you attach all the supporting documents like your curriculum, your degree certificate, your certificate, your curriculum, details about the institute, etc., etc., and you submit your application with all these documents for our evaluation. There's a specific panel in the university, in the faculty, that goes through this application and decide, oh, okay, this course is somewhat similar to very similar to the course that we are offering. So if he has passed or she has passed this subject, we can give her or him an exemption. And in some cases, we say, okay, no, this even though you have got the certificate, this has nothing to do with the subject that we are offering, so we can't recognize that. But that will happen only after you submit an application. We will do the evaluation and we'll let you know, okay, you can get an exemption for this or you cannot get an exemption for this. So you have to go to the guidebook, appendix 3 lists how you can apply for this exemption and make an application. If you think that you have other qualification that is not listed there, but that you consider, okay, this looks like, you know, I have done 2-year Java programming course and I have got the certificate and this much work I have done. So you can submit your application and say, can you exempt me from Java programming course or web application development course? And one of the questions that came up I think yesterday was that, okay, you know, I have been a web developer forever. Even from grade 9, I learned how to develop web. So many years I have been developing websites. I have developed hundreds of websites. Can I get exemption for web development course? Now, unless you have a proper accredited qualification, we cannot consider work experience as for exemption. So you have to have certification and details of the institute, etc., to get an exemption, right? So like I said, your course fee will be decided on what number of courses you are planning. So if you get for the first semester, you take all 17 credits, then you have paid in full. If you decide, okay, I'm going to do only not 17 credits in the first semester, I'm going to do only 12, okay, your fee will be lesser than if you are doing the full credit load. And like I said, you know, you have an installment plan. You can pay it 30% the first installment, 30% second installment, 20% and 20% the other two experiments during the year. And when you come to September, when you register for semester two courses, they will be added to your voucher and voucher amount will be changed. Because right now we are registering you for the first semester only. So the voucher amount will be based on the first semester subject. When you register for the second semester subject, new vouchers will be generated and your fee will go up because the course fees for the second semester will be included in your voucher as well. Right. So usually the Open University right now at this moment we are charging 3,000 rupees for each credit that you are taking. So if you are taking 10 credits, that will be 30,000 rupees. If you are taking all 17 credits, that will be 21,000 rupees. Then there are these other smaller payments which are for other things like the registration fee and there's a e-gap course you will have to pay. E-fill course we don't charge, but that is compulsory. So the actual fee will depend on how many courses you do. Usually you do about 33 credits. That comes to about 99,000 rupees a year. And generally the university increases these fees because of inflation and all that. So this year there's no increment. The same as the last year, because we understand people are going through financial difficulties, but it might slightly increase for the next year. But for this year, it is 3,000 rupees per credit. So if you are doing 33 credits, that will be 99,000 rupees for as the course fee. Okay, then the government, when we offered, I mean, I told you that we are doing this program because the government asked us, hey, start training more people because the industry needs it. So we, when this issue came, we told the government, look, some of our students have financial problems because these are not the education is not free at the Open University. We have to charge course fees because part of our cost is funded by student fee. And we told the government, why don't you give a loan scheme? Because right now the government gives loans to students who are following degrees in private universities. We said, okay, give us the same benefit to our students as well. So the government has agreed. The president himself has agreed. Now the it has gone to the Cabinet of Ministers. Cabinet of Ministers has asked for observations from different entities, and now it is approved. But the only issue is that the still the government has not instituted a mechanism to issue these loans, which bank, what documents to submit, etc., has not instituted. We are waiting. We are actually discussing with the government to give us the details very quickly, because the students are starting the course. Right now, the loan scheme is, we are waiting for the government to give us the details of the loan scheme. So right now, the loan scheme is not available, but it will be made available within the, let's hope, the next month or so, the mechanism will be available. Then we will inform you so you can apply for the loan scheme. But until the loan scheme comes, you will have to register, right? Pay the fee and register. So what we are recommending is that if you are going to apply for the loan scheme, you take the minimum number of credits that you have to take. That is 9 credits, right? 9 credits. If you take 9 credits, your first installment will come to only about 12,000 rupees, right? So you can pay that and register. And then when the loan scheme is offered, what we will do is we will get the loan from the government on behalf of you, and we will reimburse the registration fees that you have already paid. So if you paid this 12,000 rupees or whatever the amount that you have paid, if the government gives you a loan, and when the loan comes to the university, we will reimburse you the fees that you have already paid. So we expect that within the next month or so, the government will tell us the details of how the loan can be applied and which bank will give you the loan. And as soon as we hear, we will inform you, okay, now the loan scheme is available. Please apply, those who want to get the loan. If you are not going to go get the loan, then yeah, you can select all the subjects and start studying. But anyway, by September, you will have your chance to add other subjects, even if you select 9 credits now. Okay. Right. Yeah. So that's a government loan scheme. The university also understands there are people with financial difficulties. We also have internal bursary schemes. That is a kind of scholarship where we give financial support to students. Now, one of these things is what we call the enrollment bursary. After you register, you can apply for this bursary. Then our staff, our academics will evaluate your performance, how many subjects you have taken, what is your progress, and may give you a bursary. Now, what happens with the bursary is, not that it's given to you in money. What we do is, say, for example, if you get a bursary of, say, 20,000 rupees, we will deduct that from your course fee for the next year. So once you register, you will be able to apply for bursary schemes. If you want to find out about bursary schemes now, you can go to this site and find out what kind of bursary schemes are available and how you can apply. Remember that you can't apply now because you are not still our student. You have to apply only after you register and select your courses. There are certain conditions that you have to comply, like, you know, your annual family income must be less than 500,000 and all that. All those things. If you satisfy all these conditions, you may be able to apply for a bursary as well. Right. Then we have also implemented what is known as a help desk system. The help desk system is actually, help desk system, right there. Help desk system is available at this site. helpdesk.openlearn.lk. You will see that most of our systems are built on this domain name openlearn.lk, and helpdesk.openlearn.lk is the helpdesk system, which is a system where you can go and find out information. All the common questions that are asked from us, we prepare a document and we upload it there. So if you go to this browseware folder, you will see that there are some documents there that describe, okay, how do I make a payment? How do I register? How do I log in? All this information is there in this folder called BSC 2021. And how to use the help desk system is available in this under general. It says, okay, how can you use the help desk system? You go there, you look at the articles that are already published there, see whether your question has been answered previously, what you need to do, and okay, you might not want to do anything. Or if you find, okay, my query is not answered here, the issue that I have is different from the issues described there, then what you do is you go to what is known as contact us here, and here both places it is there. You do contact us and you generate what we call the system called a ticket. That is an issue. You generate an issue. It will ask you to, okay, enter your email address, enter your issue, select the category of the issue, and describe the issue. So once you do that and submit that, that will come direct to our system. And there are people who are looking at this system and answering your queries. Sometimes the query is a very simple query. Okay, I didn't get this notification, so we will send you the notification. Sometimes it might be more complicated. Look, I forgot to add one subject. I want to add that subject. Can I do that? All those queries, you put it there. And when you put a ticket, when you generate a ticket, that means you submit an issue, it will send you an email to the email address that you have listed there. It will send you an email with the link to that particular ticket. So when you click on that ticket, it will take you back to the help desk system and it will ask you to log in. The only issue now is that you don't have a password to log into the system. Then what you do is you go there and you enter your email address and then you say, I forgot my password. And there's a button that says forgot password. Then you click that and then it will send you another email saying this is how you can reset your password. That you have to do only the very first time that you log into the help desk system. After that, you can use that username and the password for many times to submit queries, find out, okay, what has happened to the query that I raised. I raised the query a week ago. Have they solved it? If it is solved, again, the system will generate an email and send you, okay, this issue has been solved. Or sometimes what happens is that you raise an issue and we need some more documentary evidence for that issue. We will send you a mail saying, through the system, please submit these documents. So you go back to the system and upload those documents. And then we will try to solve that. So this is also going to be part of your student support system, helpdesk.open.learn.lk. Right. So that is what we during your registration process. And once you have registered, we will be sending you an email. So make sure that you type your correct email address. Right now, we are having problems with about 50 people who have typed their email addresses incorrect. You have been sending SMSs. Then SMSs also don't go because you have typed your phone number incorrect. We have no way of communicating with you. Right? So make sure that you type your details correctly. And if you go to this site, you will be able to find more information. And if you if you need to contact us, right, you can go to what is known as BSC. Sorry, I can't write well. reg@ousl.lk. You send an email to this address. We will get back to you as quickly as possible. You have to be a little bit patient because sometimes we get 600, 700 emails a day. So we are going through it. some of these emails require a lot of processing. Some are very quick, but we will respond to you within a considerable time. But I suggest you use the help desk system to submit whatever the queries that you have without sending email. That will be much quicker thing, and then you don't have to call us and send another email saying, I sent an email a week ago, what happened to it? You will yourself will be able to go and see what has happened to your issue. So use the help desk system if you want to communicate us, but still this email address is also available to you. Right, so that is what we have as a presentation. Now you can ask any questions that you have. Dr. Udita is here to answer questions. I can answer questions.